Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's event is a discussion about QCC's 2021 Welcome Read Book, John Lewis's graphic memoir, March, Book One, featuring our special guest, the book's illustrator, Nate Powell. This event is a conversation between the KHC and QCC's English department, pre-college programs, and the Center for Tutoring and Academic Support. The discussion is also connected to the KHC's newest exhibition, The Concentration Camps, Inside the Nazi System of Incarceration and Genocide. The Kupferberg Holocaust Center in Bayside, New York, is situated on the traditional land of the Mantinecock people who continue to live here today. We offer gratitude and respect to all of the people of Turtle Island, past, present, and future, including the Lenape and Shinnecock peoples. What I just read is what we call a land acknowledgement. This is a statement recognizing that the land we all occupy in the course of our daily lives, including our schools, jobs, parks, and homes, including the names of towns and roads, was first inhabited by another group of people who were forcibly expelled and murdered. Today, we identify those crimes for what they are: mass atrocities and genocide. These horrors continue to have devastating political, social, psychological, economic, and environmental impacts upon and within Native American and Indigenous communities. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce my esteemed colleague, Bonnie Flaherty, Director of CUNY START Program and this year's Welcome Read Coordinator. Welcome, Bonnie.
Thank you for that introduction, Dr. Cohen. I am thrilled to be here with everybody today to talk about March, Book One, with Nate Powell, the artist and illustrator for the graphic novel series. Before we get started and turn it over to Nate, I want to tell you a little bit about him. Artist Nate Powell was born and raised in Little Rock, Arkansas, and came to New York City in the late 1990s to study at the School of Visual Arts. He now lives in Bloomington, Indiana, with his family, and his work includes the John Lewis March trilogy and the graphic memoir essay, Save It for Later. Powell is the first cartoonist to ever win the National Book Award, which he won for March Book Three. Nate is here today to talk with all of us about his process in March and the collaborative process with John Lewis and to take some of your questions and just to hear some of your thoughts on the book. And with that, Nate, thank you for being here with us. I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. I've been really encouraged by the depth and sincerity of all of the conversation y'all have been having. So really, I'd kind of like to continue that. And I have some preliminary questions that y'all sent to me. And I'm just going to burn through this. I also have a really brief slideshow that gives a breakdown of our creative process from Andrew and Congressman Lewis, you know, turning his stories into script and then me turning it into comics at the table. And then I hope to leave as much room as possible for more questions, because that's really the best part about doing any kind of a visitor talk like this. All righty. So the origin story for March as a project predates me by a couple of years. So Andrew Iden, who is the co-writer along with the late, great Congressman Lewis, can you guys hear me okay? Okay. But Andrew actually wrote the script for the books and did a ton of additional research and sort of built together the structure and the framing of the entire saga. But since early 2007, he was a staffer for Congressman Lewis in his congressional office. And it was during the 2008 campaign cycle, towards the end of the summer. And throughout that summer of just campaigning and knocking on doors and talking to people, the same questions kept coming up over and over again in meetings that they would have in John Lewis's office. How do we reintroduce the history of the civil rights movement? How do we sort of revitalize the sense of urgency around civic engagement, but especially the role of young people in civic engagement and in protest. And through that, how do we highlight the role that young people played within the civil rights movement? Basically, Andrew was getting gently made fun of in the office because there was like a break, people were going on vacation, and he was headed off to this huge Comic-Con in Atlanta. So, you know, he was being made fun of for being a nerd. John Lewis stepped to his defense and basically was like, don't make fun of him. There was a comic book during the movement when I was a teenager and it was very influential. And the comic he was talking about, yes, Beth Ann's got a printout of the cover right there. It was a 1956 book called Martin Luther King Jr. and the Montgomery Story. It was a 16-page comic that was published by an organization called the Fellowship of Reconciliation. And basically, it was a primer on the history of organized nonviolence, as well as an on-the-ground history of the Montgomery bus boycott. So within 16 pages, it breaks down a lot of the thought, a lot of the philosophy, and a lot of the carrying out on the ground from local activists. Andrew had never heard of this comic at the time. It was actually like in its era, in the 1950s and 60s, it was, you know, literally given away and sold out of the trunks of cars from Jim Lawson and from Dr. King, from other early leaders and nonviolent organizers when they were doing workshops in church basements and community centers. There were like 250,000 copies printed at first. And teenage John Lewis in his workshops with Jim Lawson was exposed to it and was used basically as a primer throughout so much of the early Nashville movement. And later on, like in the 60s, it was used by Cesar Chavez in the labor movement out in California. There it was translated to Spanish. It also made its way into various people's movements and labor movements in Central and South America. In the early 2010s, like we've seen bootleg translations all over the world. It was translated into Arabic and Farsi during pro-democracy movements from, you know, Libya all the way through eastward through the Middle East. It has an amazing history. Anyway, at the time, it had totally fallen into obscurity. And Andrew was like, what is this comic you're talking about? So he went home and thankfully someone had just digitized it the year prior and put it up on crmvets.org. He read it and he was so captivated by it. And basically he just made it his mission to be like, you know what? I've got a vision. The answer to all of these pressing questions seems like it could be that you need to make a comic about your role as a young person at the center of the civil rights movement. And John Lewis was like, well, maybe. And it was just very polite in shooting him down because it just seemed like a fairly preposterous thing at first. But Andrew really saw his vision fully executed. And he's a really stubborn dude. He stayed with it for months and months. And eventually Congressman Lewis was like, all right, but only if you write it with me. So they spent like the next 2 years doing a working draft of the entire trilogy. Originally, it was just going to be one giant book. And they signed a book deal with my longtime publisher with no artist. And I guess that's where I come in. I was wrapping up work on some other books and I read this press release for this project March. And I was like, oh, what an awesome idea. And great to be highlighting John Lewis. I personally don't know enough about John Lewis. This would have been maybe late 2010, early 2011. But basically I was like, well, back to work. And, you know, the absence of an artist mentioned in the press release, like I didn't put two and two together that there was no artist yet. But thankfully, my publisher called me and strongly recommended that I try out for the role of artist. So he connected me to Congressman Lewis and to Andrew. And from there, it was a really direct back and forth. I got some sample pages of script. I made some demo pages. I got notes back from them and I redrew those pages. But really, we just clicked on a personal level. And within about 2 weeks, we just decided to go straight ahead and become a team together. And we really never looked back from that moment. So I guess that's the origin story of the book. Now I'm going to attempt to share my screen to do a quick just kind of like process breakdown for how it worked. here we are. This is just a few days after finishing the artwork on March Book One. I joined Andrew and Congressman Lewis on an annual pilgrimage of civil rights landmarks and sites throughout the state of Alabama. So that's us at the foot of the Pettus Bridge. It was a really transformative experience, but also as a kid who spent my elementary school years in Montgomery, Alabama, a lot of the sites of these landmarks in central Alabama I had been to as a child and yet had not returned to with like a much deeper context and a lot more to unpack. So in a lot of ways, which we'll get into later, it was sort of like a re-education. And my work on the books wound up basically being like paid to go back to school to relearn this history and hopefully contribute to it. Once the script gets to me, my tools are really simple. And really, because of my exact age, I still do everything physically on paper, except I clean up my files on Photoshop. And a lot of that just like, you know, growing up in pre-internet Arkansas, my high school, like my class was the last class where there were zero computers in the school. And even when I went to School of Visual Arts, my year of cartooning students was the last year before you were required to take any digital art classes whatsoever. So here's what I got. I just use cheap pens for lettering. I just use a mechanical pencil and a simple eraser. And I use a crow quill nib or a number two watercolor brush for most of my inking. And I just dip it in black India ink. And all those gray washes you see are just made by diluting the India ink with different amounts of water and just using them like watercolors, except they're permanent as soon as they dry. One thing I love about comics is because it is so accessible and so simple, like none of the tools have to be complicated at all. All right. So just to make sure the screen share is working, are you looking at the page of script? Good. So this is an original page of script from Andrew's script. This is the moment in March Book One where young John Lewis is arrested for the very first time outside of the Woolworths. So basically, you'll see here that he has it noted as being on page 64. As soon as I got the script, I was even a little heavy-handed about this, but we had a creative agreement that I was going to sort of repace the book according to my own storytelling needs. A lot of March Book One really is the story of Andrew and I learning to write and draw for each other and sort of getting up to a clip and getting to a level of collaboration that allowed us to really move forward in the rest of the trilogy. So for us, book two is very different and it's much more cohesive storytelling wise than March Book One. In March Book One, there are parts where we're getting our footing and we're kind of realizing what we need to focus on more, what we need to focus on less, what the expectations are. But here within the pages of this script, one of the most important rules for storytelling is show, don't tell. And especially with a visual medium like comics, I'd say doubly so. So for example, originally you have the caption or have a description here in panel two, white protesters are led to one paddy wagon while the black protesters are led to another. And I'm drawing off of that description and getting the reference I need to make that scene work in real space. The original caption, however, was they segregated the whites and the blacks into different vehicles. However, my job as a cartoonist, if I can show that in the pages of the art, we don't need to add a caption in John Lewis's voice describing what a reader should be able to see. And basically, like the other dance I had to learn how to do was, it's really important to note that John Lewis was a lifelong oral storyteller from his days as a boy preacher into his days, leading the young people's wing of the civil rights movement. Andrew was able to find the earliest documented example of him telling the chicken story, which was in 1961. He was 21 years old the first time we're positive he was telling that story. So sometimes a lot of the ways in which John Lewis would deliver the story would have word usage and sentence structure that didn't work perfectly for absorbing his account on the printed page. And so there are moments in March Book One where I would go in and be like, well, I'll just tweak this a bit. I'll smooth this over. Thankfully, Andrew kind of like hit pause and called me out. He was like, the thing is, like, there's a sanctity to these words because he has been mastering telling these stories in front of a live audience for decades. And so basically, it was a good way to check myself. Like, I sort of had to go the other way around. It involved preserving the sanctity of his words and shifting the way I told stories in order to accommodate his language and his word choice better. So from breaking this down to my own sense of pacing, we move on to the thumbnail stage. And usually so they're called thumbnails because usually these are really only like an inch or two high. And I'm really breaking down these two pages just enough to show that there's enough space for everything to happen on the page. There's enough space for the text to fit and to show that the eye as we read through can flow. And that's all we need to do. And usually I'll do these 10 or 20 at a time and just really burn through the book. And from there, I move up to like larger, nicer paper. And these are my original pencils for these two pages. And here you can see I've penciled in all of the lettering. Some of my pencil artwork is still really loose. And a lot of that's because I like to think with the ink. It makes it a lot more expressive and brings a lot more vitality to the drawings. But also there is like a matter of speed and efficiency involved too. You got to keep going. And sometimes it's easier to redraw something than it is to really get hung up on one figure or one image for too long. And from there, once everything checked out with everybody, I would go in and I would finish up the lettering with pen. Then I would do my line art, just the black only with pen and brush. And then I would do gray washes over that and then go in these little spots where some of the drawing is done with pencil or white ink. So, you know, interestingly, every time you see one page of comic book art, you're really seeing four or five pages worth of effort or labor that went into it. Now that's it from a screen share. All right. Now from there, I guess my personal context for the history of the civil rights movement and what led me into my work on the March trilogy I was born in the late 70s and I spent a lot of the 1980s living in Alabama. My family, you know, they're white baby boomers from Mississippi and they graduated from high school in the mid 60s. And I, like a lot of other, white Southerners with white baby boomer parents, I did get a basic working knowledge of the civil rights movement at some level. But importantly, like in the 1980s, a lot of baby boomers from the South, a lot of white baby boomers from the South had a lot of baggage they were not yet ready to unpack, or they didn't realize they hadn't unpacked it yet. So when I would be getting like this history and these anecdotes from my parents, a lot of times each bit of history would come with a bit of a disclaimer that would always be like throwing a smoke bomb. It would be like, oh, but that was another time. Like, oh, this is not that. There is this implied disconnection between the past and the present, a lack of continuity. And what's weird is like the older I get, I realize, you know, they're telling me about this history that was taking place just 10 to 15 years before I was born. And like 15 years is nothing the older I get. That's nothing. But also a lot of the locations that I would see in this grainy black and white footage or video coverage would be, you know, sites in downtown Montgomery, just 3 miles from my house where I was receiving this history, places where I'd gone to visit with my family or on a school field trip. And yet there seemed to be a lot of effort on some level put into not making a connection that these were real people involved with real actions in our world, the same world. And there was kind of just a sense of abstraction about it. And so, that resulted thankfully in a lot of questions and discussions as I got older. But eventually, a lot of it having to do with moving to the Midwest and discovering a lot of different dimensions of American racism outside of the what we consider like the traditional Southern perspective on racism and inequality in the United States. So my work on March in a lot of ways was to destroy the well-meaning miseducation, like the ways in which my parents and their generation had been hardwired to talk about the history of the movement, was basically to undercut that. I see how my generation had been misinformed by it. And thankfully, you know, we are able to go with what we know and build from there. I'd say to bust into the rest of the questions that we got originally. All right. Yeah. How was I able to illustrate John Lewis's story with all the details of the time period? Thankfully, John Lewis was kind of like a collector nerd and a pack rat and an archivist. So the very first time I met him, I went to his congressional office and I walked in and I was like, what is this room? There's just like a little table about this big with a couple of chairs, and everything else was framed pictures and stacks of photos and memorabilia, files. And Andrew was like, yeah, this is the congressman's office. Like, it's like a museum. So thankfully, they both did a really good job supplying me with a lot of entry-level reference. But on one level, like when I'm reading the pages of script, you have to develop a set of eyes for information or for what's missing in between the lines of a script. Sometimes if there's something that is not specified, it means that's my job to find that information and just fill in the gaps. And a lot of that's because I'm a visual artist, so I'm a visual thinker. And so it's important to kind of allow yourself to walk around in your subjects or your character's shoes. It also helped that I was physically familiar with a lot of these locations. And so I remembered the lay of the land, the lay of certain streets, the way certain kinds of plants grew throughout Alabama and Mississippi and Tennessee. And all of these things helped me so that I'd realize I needed to get extra batches of material. And then a lot of it comes down to like the stuff that I actually don't care at all about doing. Like, some people love researching shoes and fashion and cars and technology for a period piece. And this is history, but it's also a period piece. And that's the part where I'm like, oh, I got to do my job. Strangely, I've never cared about cars in my life, but over the course of doing the March trilogy, I actually developed a fondness for mid-century American cars just by spending so much time having to render them at some passable level. Also, I sort of like, I always kept Congressman Lewis's memoir, Walking with the Wind, by my side to sort of compare the way he was describing events in his memoir with what he and Andrew had worked up together with the script of our book. And then, you know, there were other historical volumes too, but importantly, I had to get a bunch of photography books. So my favorites are Powerful Days, which is a photography book by Charles Moore. And a lot of this is, you know, like this really underlines the fact that these are specific individuals, many still alive, some not with us anymore, involved at various protests throughout the American South, and recognizing these moments that are often, you know, don't receive the focus they should throughout history. And using that for other details, like whether it's mundane details like doors, windows, bricks, or whether it's with other unidentified or under-recognized people who were involved as activists or as perpetrators from the same events. Like, this, here's a fantastic book, Breach of Peace, which features mugshots and profiles on all 289 arrested freedom riders. This was a fantastic resource throughout March Book 2. And it also had enough information on each specific rider that, like, if you want to really get into it, you can start mapping which riders were on which buses through which days of the Freedom Ride. because as the trilogy continued, you know, like ultimately I was dealing with a cast of hundreds of real people. And so it was important to all of us not to sweep those people under the rug for their contributions, but to highlight them whenever they could. And as the trilogy progressed, we recognized that it was more important to also, you know, be mindful to highlight the contributions of women in the movement, to highlight, you know, other marginalized voices, like at the center of the movement, the organizer of the March on Washington, Bayard Rustin, who was basically defamed in the halls of Congress for being gay as a means to undercut the legitimacy of the March on Washington itself, and was basically given, was not the public-facing head of the March on Washington, though he was the organizer, because strategically his existence was considered a liability to the movement. So a lot of the push and pull that you'll see documented in March Book 2 simply has to do with these other important voices, which are swept under the rug. How long did it take me to finish? Thankfully, there were breaks in between each book, but during those breaks, it was basically back to school time. We were writing, editing, researching, but also touring on a weekly basis across the country. And while we were in person touring and talking, doing signings, that was really my in-person time to ask my own questions of Congressman Lewis with different details or getting him to retell certain stories. This is a big part of the process of writing the book, was Andrew and then later me getting John Lewis to tell the same story ultimately four or five times. And every time new details would emerge. Even years after the trilogy was finished, like the last event we ever did together was there in New York City for the Department of Education in December 2019. And I don't remember the anecdote that John Lewis briefly told during that talk, but that late in the game, every single time we would talk, he would tell some kind of a story and reveal some little detail where Andrew and I would be like, oh, Congressman, why couldn't you have told us that 5 years ago? It's such a great detail, or what a like forgotten moment, what sliver of this history. And he's like, well, a lot happened. He's like, you should have asked better questions. And so it was really great. Like the process of touring while we were making these books meant we had to keep our listening ears on at all times, and also keep our eyes and ears open for what was a very noticeable, you know, rightward shift in, you know, our social and political reality during the years in which this book was made, from 2012 through 2016. And so having important conversations about whether or not we needed to get in the ring, like during March Book 3, do we need to get in the ring in the pages of the book to speak to the audience of the 2010s or the 2020s? And ultimately, our answer was always, if we do our job correctly, we don't need to, because any reader of this book lives in the same world as us. We're experiencing all of this, and you know, people are going to make those connections as long as we do our job correctly. I'd say, yeah, the last of these questions is more process related, but this is a really good one. Why is the book cover art in color, but the interior of the book is in black and white? Now, there are really three reasons. Number one, black and white comics is still kind of the gold standard for like independent literary graphic novels. I mean, half of those graphic novels are in color, but there is a space in a lot of nerds' hearts for black and white comics. So that was fine enough. Importantly, going back to the way that I, as a kid, absorbed civil rights movement history, really anyone born after the 1960s, every single one of us, the way that we relate to history before 1970 is in black and white, particularly the history of the civil rights movement. So instead of trying to, and basically it's like doing this book in color would take twice as long, and it wouldn't necessarily add anything information-wise or to the experience of the book, but I actually felt it would undercut a reader's ability to identify with the history, which is strange. Like, we're just hardwired to experience civil rights movement history in black and white. I decided to embrace that, and hopefully that paid off to some degree. Alrighty. I think that should do it for now, and we have enough time. I would love to answer as many questions as I could. This is your time, and I don't want to waste it, so fire away.
Thank you, Nate. I have a question in the chat, and this is from Dr. Laura Cohen. Could you please ask, where do you see March in relation to other seminal graphic novels about human rights violations and mass atrocities, including Mouse and Safe Area Garadze about the Bosnian War?
I guess on one level, I feel like it's not my place to rest it among the canon, but I do know that, you know, all of us were inspired by the proof of concept from each one of, like, the big dogs, from Mouse to Persepolis to Safe Area Garajda. Our understanding was finding a way to do something that functioned also as history and memoir, and to find a way to be able to convey those in a space which allowed people to process it both on that closer, more intimate, subjective level and with a little bit more historical distance. And that's something, rereading Mouse in the last few years, it had been a while for me. And I was really, really moved by the balance that Art Spiegelman was able to attain in the 1980s in his work on Mouse. And so I wasn't looking at Mouse or Persepolis, for example, when I was at the table doing March, but I tried to keep it in mind and, like, have a presence about it. And so looking back now that I'm finished with the trilogy has been a really enlightening and harrowing experience sometimes. I do know that, you know, March is taught in almost every state in the country, and I'm pretty sure it's the preeminent means by which a whole generation is learning about the civil rights, the history of the movement. And for me, that's the most important part of all. I'd say that, you know, a lot of our collective mission in doing March was to undercut what the SPLC would call the 9-word problem, which is that most American kids graduate from high school knowing 9 words about the civil rights movement: Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream. That was certainly me. And you can't come up with a coherent narrative of civil rights movement history, how it worked or what it meant, especially when you're telling a tale of what Andrew calls a tale of gods and kings. So in trying to decentralize the history of the movement, I mean, ironically, since John Lewis was very much at and near the center of that movement, he was very focused throughout in working to decentralize it as the movement itself, or at least as SNCC fought hard to have a decentralized movement.
Thank you. I think we've got a question here from Jasira. Jasira, I'm gonna ask you to unmute.
Hello. Okay. I have a very specific question about page 93. See, you probably want to look what that is. So I wrote an analysis on this page, and I wanted to know what your idea or intention was behind creating this page and what the thought process was like.
Okay. Well, first off, is it the physical book? Or I just want to make sure I have the page number right. Is it this splash page here?
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's definitely this page. I literally have this page.
You bet. Awesome. Okay. Well, interestingly, the original script for March Book One, because Andrew was, like, mostly inspired by this 1950s comic about the Montgomery bus boycotts, a lot of the script was done in kind of like a 6-panel grid, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Stylistically, it was very similar to comics of that era. And so I mean, if I were to start over again, I think I actually might follow a little bit more of the structure that Andrew had set up. But when I got on board, I certainly had these moments where, to me, it was all about finding enough breathing room and also finding enough of the personal and subjective experiences surrounding the history and pulling those out from the history, pulling these moments out and expanding on them. To me, that was what provided for the best connection. So a lot of times that has to do, when you're talking about from the perspective of the young activists, capturing these moments of uncertainty, of anxiety, of fear. And so in this moment, yes, you have, I think this might be phase three of their trial sit-ins, and they're being denied by the wait staff. And eventually there's a counter-closed sign put up. They persevere, and eventually the lights are turned off as we have observer activists from the sit-in movement who are here to monitor and here to switch out with other protesters, but also hecklers have begun to mingle in the darkness too. A lot of it is breathing room. When you have a single panel page or just a large panel, you're expanding the reader's sense of time passing. When I have the artwork go all the way to the edges as a full bleed image, that expands the sense of time further. And in general, like, it's time travel is very real when we're reading a comic, and our experience of time passing is very different from a panel that has borders, where we're containing everything within those seconds that you're reading, and moving into a panel where you're taking out the borders gives us like one extra breath, and this panel seems to linger for an instant. And so having a totally borderless panel sometimes can extend the passage of time infinitely if you need it to. So in one panel, having the experience of sitting in the dark for hours, and I actually think the script on the next page was like, yeah, we sat in that eerie quiet for several hours. In one panel, we're able to convey the entire experience simply by resting on this moment. I could have done a 6-panel page that shows time passing maybe through the window outside, the light changing, but I wanted to push the darkness instead of focusing on, you know, the sunlight changing outside. So that was my solution to the problem.
Nate, I just want to share a comment in the chat. I absolutely love this page, the student says. It stood out to me. I felt really drawn in, and I think it accurately portrayed the solemnness of the moment. Kind of scary, but real.
Thank you. I mean, a lot of it simply had to do with, oftentimes, I'd feel like early on, you know, there was like a level of anxiety of being able to tell this history, but to convey the experiences of people I hadn't met in a struggle that I tried to be as involved with as I can, but one which, because of my skin privilege, I can't fully understand in the most immediately impactful way. So oftentimes I would return back to the fact that Congressman Lewis chose me to tell his story through his eyes, in his words, that ultimately it's never about me when it comes to making March and sort of like recentering myself with, this is my job, this is my focus. And I really felt a lot freer without the anxiety of, basically, that's one of these moments where I think like any doubts or anxiety I would have about conveying any of the more intense moments of violence or pushback, a lot of that just winds up being like some part of your brain that wants to make it about you again. And so there's a lot of just kind of like reminding yourself you got a job to do.
I feel like you anticipated the next question I had in the chat, which was from a student in Jonathan's class. How did you feel about writing about John Lewis's life, given that you're writing about someone who has lived such a different experience from your own?
Yeah, well, a lot of that is an intergenerational reckoning. And a lot of that simply has to do with like this sounds very like William Faulkner-y or whatever, but like, you know, growing up one generation removed from the end of what is demarcated as the era of Jim Crow segregation in the South, but still growing up in a very segregated American South. The older you get, the more acutely aware you are how close the shadow of Jim Crow segregation was, and all the ways in which it permeated every aspect of life. It's a constant kind of reassessment of the world. For me, it's a constant reassessment of the world and the factors which shaped me, and the ways in which I learned to ask questions about the world around me and what I decided to do about it. I'm thankful that, like, as a young teenager, I got involved in like underground punk and with other teenagers and young people who were also like creative and cared and were able to, you know, do cool stuff with not a lot of resources. But most importantly, it encouraged this notion that it's okay, or even that you need to speak up and speak out, not just about injustice, but that there are space for people's voices. But yeah, there's like a tension there because, like, obviously, like, I can be a very self-absorbed person as a solo graphic novelist. And I just kind of, there are moments where I just live in my head to tell these stories. And this, like, this little section of my studio is my whole world for half of each day, you know. But in a lot of circumstances, in a lot of books I'm involved with, it involves recognizing that I've got a skill set which is used to do something more than simply to tell the story, more than simply to make the book. And so for this, like, yeah, I had doubts and anxieties at first, but thankfully Congressman Lewis is like really consistent about making you feel empowered and recognizing that he had faith in you and believed in you. But also, yeah, like ultimately it's not about me. Like I want to illuminate this story. I want to revitalize it. I want these books to have the influence they've had because they need to.
Thank you, Nate. I think we have time for, I just have a comment in the chat from Shafiq saying the graphics really give us more details about the current time and also paint a picture of what's going on in Mr. Lewis's time. So like feeling that presence. And then I think, Brittany, did you have a question that you wanted to ask?
Yes, I did. So question for you, Nate. How did you feel having all this knowledge dropped on you like that, like from what you've already learned throughout school to like how you educated yourself and decided to pursue this?
That's an excellent question because it really, I think at the core of it is the fact that hopefully having a bunch of knowledge dropped on you or revealed to you is an ongoing experience. So a lot of it, you know, like a lot of my work on March between 2012 and 2016 was a continuation of questions and learning and reading that I had had in the previous couple of years, whether it was working on a book like The Silence of Our Friends or back in 2007, I think one of the most influential books in my life was by the recently departed author James Lewin, his book called Sundown Towns, A Hidden Dimension of American Racism. And as I mentioned, yeah, I'm a Southerner. I moved up here to Indiana in 2004 and it took a few years to really settle in and begin to see the lower Midwest with more objective eyes. But this account of the history of enforced segregation on a city, on a community-wide level, known as sundown towns, the fact that it persisted to the present day, the legal runarounds which allow sundown towns to continue existing without being noticed or without being called out was shocking. But also, this was like the first major dent in this sort of mythical framing of the American South as being the backwards racist part of America, was growing up as a Southerner. I knew of this phenomenon known as sundown towns, where non-white people were not allowed to exist in the town within the city limits after sundown, basically removing the ability of anyone who wasn't white to live in the town. It was always implied, and thus I always thought and continued the myth that this is a Southern phenomenon, when in fact, there are only like a dozen sundown towns in the entire American South. There are up to 500, which continue to this day, just in my state of Indiana. There are another 500, one state over in Illinois. These are the two worst states in America for sundown towns. And there are about 5,000 total historical sundown towns. So like that set my mind on a set of thought and work and action, which led to reassessing my world in a lot of ways, which led up to the present moment. And so a lot of this is recognizing that like different aspects to whether it's the history of the movement or the history of activism in America, the history of racism and inequality in America, and the context in different parts of America, none of this was dropped on me all at once. And a lot of it is recognizing that when a chunk of this information is coming your way, it's time to be receptive to it and recognize that that's going to open up other doors. Like we never stop. Not only do we never stop learning, but we never stop needing to reassess what we have already learned. Because, you know, part of history is confronting the fallacies in previously documented history. Like we're lucky that in March we had a couple of chances to correct the historical record for the first time and a couple of chances to contribute to the historical record for the first time. Like March Book 2 is the first book ever published that correctly identifies the original 13 Freedom Riders. And we were actually able to trace the footprints through the forest to show where way back in 1961 or 62, where that information trail went just slightly awry. So that's really part of the journey of making these books, was recognizing how our account of history is in the hands of people who write about history. So that's been a wild ride and something that I never frankly thought that I would play any sort of a role in. So that's amazing.
Thank you, Nate. I know that we're just wrapping up our kind of hitting our time limit here. So I want to be really mindful of that. But I also wanted to share one of the students put in the chat, which I'll share with everyone now, a link to a PDF of the original kind of inspirational comic that you were talking about, which I know people who are in the welcome reading classes have been looking at. And I wanted to thank you for framing this as we never stop. The need to learn never stops. I don't know, President Mangino, did you want to jump in on that?
I had asked the question and nobody came back with it. So I do hope that, you know, something resonates in their education, right? That they get that each of the students do have this epiphany moment of finding where their passion is and what they want to do going forward, and that, you know, they find that in our classrooms.
Yeah. Nate, something else that you said really stuck out for me, that you have a specific skill set that you found a way to use for something bigger than just that skill. And that idea of finding purpose, I think is really a powerful thing for all of us to hear. So thank you for that.
Oh, you bet. And also it's just the fact that like we each have concrete skills and strengths, but there's also something to be said for like a lot of the change that was able to happen through the movement and through the movements that we have all experienced in this previous decade. A lot of it has to do with people who are willing to show up. And it's important not to undercut the significance of people who have limited access to resources or time, or who have less willingness or ability to take the risk of taking a hit or going to jail. Sometimes it's really important just to magnify that change becomes more possible the more people show up. And when you can't show up, know that other people have got your back and they're going to show up for you. And that means when they can't do it, it's on you to show up whenever you can.
Thank you, Nate. I think that takes us right back to that illustration that we were looking at, and that there are people in the background who are ready to step in. So that's really, really wonderful. Thank you, Nate, for being with us here today in our strange Zoom world. It's one of the advantages of this, that we get to speak with you and learn more about your process, and really the inspiring story of working on this book. I know that we've all learned a lot from the talk today. I also want to thank everyone involved in this year's welcome read, and for the KHC for sponsoring this event. It's been a pleasure to be with all of you. Thank you.